as the contents of that book. It will, going through this lesson will help us understand the message in this book, which is a worldwide used Adventist evangelism tool. So, in introduction, we are going to look at this as the plan of redemption unfolds, a systematic strategy is hatched. Definite steps are put forward for Adam's descendants, that's you and I, who would be willing to accept the free gift of God's saving power in the person of Christ to overcome, that's helping us to overcome the world and its allurements. Now, Sabbath school lesson in the morning, children were talking about adverts. Adverts are there to allure you, to attract you, to draw your attention to certain things that are being put across. Now, the world is putting things on us that are trying to allure us, to attract our attention, to focus not on the Lord, but to focus on the world and its allurements. That's why it's there. Now, there are certain steps that are in the book. If you all have a copy of this book. There are certain steps, as in chapters in that book, that are the way they are arranged. If you look at them from the first one to the end, you will understand why we are here and why the church or our church takes that book as an evangelism tool. Not only to evangelize outside, but to evangelize to ourselves. Now, if you look at the chapters, you will see the first one is saying God's love for man. It is important that before you look at everything else, before anything, there was God. And we say God is love, isn't it? It's not a character of God, but it's a person of God. Love is a person of God. And after seeing the love of God, we will realize the sinner's need for Christ. We will look at repentance, confession, consecration, faith and acceptance, the test of discipleship, and also look at growing up into Christ. At this stage, now we're looking at someone who is already converted. The work and the life, the knowledge of God, the privilege of prayer, what to do with doubt, and rejoicing in the Lord. These are the steps that we will take through, or that we will take through as we study the lesson. Today we're not going to take as many, we're not going to go through all those, and we're not going to go into detail about this, the chapters that we'll look at, but it's just a summary of what the book is teaching us as the steps to Christ. And chapter 1, God's love for men. What do you think is God's love for men? What do you think is God's love for men? Without reading, just by looking at a glance, what do you think it means? God's love for men.
He is the creator, so he loves.
He is the creator of nature, isn't it? So since he is the creator of nature, for his love for men, his love for men is seen also in nature. If you look in the world around us, there's all things that we see there. We see the love of God in it. The love of God was bestowed in nature because when he created in the Garden of Eden, he put all the herbs and for food. He put all the herbs for medicine, isn't it? We've just been having our lunch, isn't it? We're all fed and ready for lay activities. what does that mean? We have eaten the food that we have had. We say grace, isn't it? Why did we say grace? We are thankful for the Lord providing that for us. But that's a sign of his love, isn't it? So there's all the food that we've had. There's herbs in it. There's all natural things in it, isn't it? What are they for? For ourselves. So that's part of God's love. If you look in the world around us, if you look in the mountains, look at the sea. Look in where we've just had snow the past few days, isn't it? What is that? That's nature. And it shows the point of the love of God. Anything interesting when you look at the point of nature? Chapter 1. Ellen G. White in this book says, nature testifies. Nature and revelation alike testify of God's love. The sunshine, the rain that gladden and refresh the earth, the hills, the seas, the plains, all speak to us of the Creator's love. It is God who supplies the daily needs of all these creatures. What we understand, or anything else, what we find in nature, that points to the love of God for man. We said in nature and in the Word of God. In the Bible, yes. The Bible is another example of God's love. Because if He had no love for us, He would have just released us and let us go. But because He loves us, He gave us His love. I mean, His care, His instructions of how we should live ourselves, how we should live with our fellow beings, isn't it? So when we look at those things, the word of God, that's the kind of love that God has for us. Yes, Elder John.
Yeah, I mean, if you've separated that, I mean, so what I was not talking about, brought it to love of Jesus Christ.
Okay.
I mean, the word of God, John 1, says the word of God became flesh.
Yes.
In the moment. So
yes.
The word of God is the person of Jesus.
Yes, it's in possession. Yes.
Right.
The first word that we're looking at is the word as in present.
I mean, even as
now we're looking at the
Jesus
word
Christ
changing, being transformed from being the word, the written word, to be the living word in the life of Jesus Christ. What did He do as a word? He said He has come. The Bible says yes, come for our good, isn't it?
Came as a living bread.
Yes, as a living bread that we should live through Him.
Yes.
And He took us from the state of being sinners, destined to die, to righteous people, destined to everlasting life. Now get this point, destined to. He did not move us from death to everlasting life, but we have a choice to make, and that calls for our faith, as you will see in the following chapters. Now, plan of salvation. The plan, God's plan of salvation is another step or another point that shows us God's love for man. So when you're going out there and when you're sharing the good news or when you're sharing the book with people, we need to show that God loved man through nature, or God still loved man through His word in the Bible. God loves man through the life of Jesus Christ, whom He sent to live on earth with us. And when He was living on earth, what did He do to show God's love? He forgave our sins, He healed our sick, and He did many other things to show God's love for man. If that wasn't the case, God wouldn't have sent His Son to live on earth, let alone die on the cross. Are we together? I don't want to take this as a lecture, but I'll take this maybe as an intro to the following chapters. Then the plan of salvation, of course, it's now pointing us to the cross. When Jesus died on the cross, He resurrected from the grave. What was that for? To show God's love for man, so that we still was the process of moving, transferring us from eternal death to eternal life. God's love for man. Now, we said about God's word, about the word of God. The word of God revealed His character. He Himself has declared His infinite love and pity. When Moses prayed, "Show me the glory," the Lord answered, "I will make all goodness pass before you." Now, that's the word of God. The word of God is his goodness. He pictured, now, instead, the devil is always fighting against God's goodness. He wants to paint a black picture on God's love for you and I. Now, if you listen, if you read Steps to Christ, paragraph, I think it's the fourth one, it says he pictured the Creator as being, as a being who is watching with jealous eye to discern the errors and mistakes of men, and that he may visit judgments upon them. It was to remove this dark shadow by revealing to the world the infinite love of God that Jesus came to live among men. We're still on chapter 120. Do you see what I mean? Are you with me? So the devil tried to picture God, a negative picture of God, because God is love, but certainly saying God is jealousy. Now, to erase this kind of dark colored picture that the devil is putting on God, he sent his son to die on the cross so that we who were doomed for death can become sons and daughters of heaven. It says here, the Son of God came from heaven to make manifest the Father. Right? We said Jesus' life is another sign that God loves us. If you read again, it says the purpose of Jesus coming to live on earth was to redeem us. That Jesus lived and suffered and he died. He became a man of sorrow that we might be made partakers of everlasting joy. So it is important for us to point those four main points when it comes to looking at to point on Christ or God's love for us. The nature, the word of God, the life of Jesus Christ, and the plan of redemption. Is there any questions on the first chapter or anything that you want to add on the first chapter?
Yes, for the sake of those out there who might bring some difficult questions, for us to get a chance to explain God's love, it's recorded in the Bible that when Adam and his wife sinned, God removed them from the Garden of Eden. Does it show love? Let's say somebody is asking you, you are presenting this to somebody.
Okay.
So you say, does it show love? Why God had to,
Let's look at that. Why, if God loved Adam and Eve, why did he throw them out of the garden? Sorry? So that they'll obey him. That's another point. And also, let me say, before he drove them out of the garden, as soon after they sinned, what happens when someone says, erred or sinned against you? You curse them, don't you? Yes, you curse them. We have to be on the side of heaven. We're not in heaven yet. We curse them. But when Adam and Eve sinned, did God curse them? He cursed the earth instead of Adam and Eve. And after cursing the earth, that's when he said, thorns and thistles will grow. Isn't it? So because of love, he spared the curse of them. Right? So let's answer the question. I want you to share this as to add on to the foundation of answering the question. Why did God drive Adam and Eve out of the garden?
I believe because the man sinned. God hadn't approved them out of there. They were pretending to us and sin, but they were only
sinned. Okay.
So God's not going to show them that there's that much guy in the game. If you had guys and sinners to God, and God will direct by one and you will resurrect one.
Right. Did you get the question, Brother John? The answer, I'll just elaborate, then I'll be able to speak. The answer that Uncle Bob gave here is because they were dwelling next to the tree of life. Instead of soon after eating the tree of life, soon after committing the sin, they'll go again and eat from the tree of life. They'll go back again and sin and eat from the tree of life, and then there's no faith. There's no obedience to the law of God.
No proper
communion with God. That's the answer from Uncle Bob. Elder Bebe, something to say?
Genesis chapter 3.
As you see through the chapters that will follow, God, by removing them off the Garden of Eden, like the Bible has rightfully said, He wanted them away from the tree of life, so that our life or our everlasting life or our salvation is not dependent on our action of walking to the tree of life, but it will be dependent on our knees to the giver of life. Measures to make sure that they are dependent on Him rather than on self. Let's move on. Chapter 2. Sinners' need for Christ. After the fall, Satan gained control of the human minds. These are the points I have. Number 2, our sinful minds are changed by Jesus. Unless our sinful minds are changed by Jesus, we will not be happy in heaven. And we will never find real happiness in the earth. So it's not just for the sake of being happy in heaven that we need Christ. We need Christ in our lives here and now so that we can live at peace with each other, so that we even can live at peace with ourselves. Right? If you read that point in the book Steps to Christ, you will hear it's saying, even if a sinner was to go to heaven, he himself was not going to be happy to be sitting amongst holy beings, or just beholding the face of Christ will make him unhappy, and he would even actually feel like running away from heaven, because he himself is not holy. And his mind But Christ changes the mind. And one of the verses in the Bible says, God says, He searches, he understands the mind better than anybody else. Right? We are born selfish in the place of love. We are born selfish in the place of love. We are born without love. But because of Christ, if we attach ourselves to Christ, like what he says in John chapter 15, abide in me and I will abide in you. Christ is God himself, and God is love, my sister.
Because for me, I don't think we were born in the selfish place.
Okay.
It's what we did by deceiving, by the slave, that we become like that. So we were not born like that.
Right.
Am I wrong?
I mean, I tell you, helping my sister, if you want to make the sentence complete, because of our sinful nature, everybody falls short. And anybody who falls short, we rather behave in a selfish way.
But we were not born like that.
Like according to the point, because of our sinful nature. Where did our sinful nature start? Because our parents sinned. Sin became the culture of this world. So we are born in the culture of tradition of sin. Does that clarify the point?
Yeah.
You wanted to say something?
No, I was just gonna say it's like we inherit.
We inherited this from our parents. Because we are sorry, what's your family? Your family said where you're born?
Utu.
You are born into the Utu family, right? Let me say Adam and Eve are the Utu, are the Utus. They sinned. We are born into this Utu family, which is a family known for sin. You understand? That's why the Bible, even the chapter that we're dealing with, talks of us being born in sin. The sin involves the sin of selfishness. Now the selfishness comes, Elder Bed will come next. When Adam and Eve sinned, God coming to speak to them, He says, Adam, have you eaten that? He said, no, God, it's the wife you gave me. He's cleaning himself. That's a selfishness attitude. And what did the wife say? It's the snake. The selfishness comes. Now, if the snake was asked, he was going to say, because Adam is going away, I was entertaining his wife. And he held a bit.
I understand the question. Psychologists and other social scientists don't just say a child is born as a clean slate. There's nothing in there.
Mm-hmm.
And then because of nature and nurture, mm-hmm. they learn to do wrong or right.
Mm-hmm.
But the Bible says in Psalms 51, verse 5 and 6, I was born a sinner. Yes. From the moment my mother conceived me, but with desire honest for the womb, teaching me to be better. So we can see that David understood that he was born by the parents or in a family, just as you say, who were deep in sin. And there is no one who could run away from that. So the nature thing, he was brought up.
Are we born sinners?
I wouldn't say we are born sinners.
No,
but we are born
into the sinful culture. Like, let's listen to this one. Steps to Christ, chapter 2, the first paragraph. Man was originally endowed with noble powers and a well-balanced mind. He was perfect in his being and in harmony with God. His thoughts were pure, his aims holy, but through disobedience, his powers were perverted and selfishness took place of love. His nature became so weakened through transgression that it was impossible for him on his own strength to resist the power of evil. Does that answer, does it say anything about the point we're discussing? I thought this would kind of help us address that point. Yes. Are we born sinners? That's the question.
Through one man, sin came into the world.
Yes.
And through one man, restoration was found.
Yes. Yeah.
So what does it mean then that through one man, sin came into the world? It means that if we came from Adam, unless we didn't come from Adam, but if we came from Adam, then that sin is still there. But through one man, Jesus, everything is reversed. And that's why there is a need for Christ. Because there's nothing you can accomplish. In fact, Genesis 6 verses 5 reads, this is now God talking. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And then when you go to Psalms chapter 15, verses 2, God looks down from heaven to see if there is any who seeks him. And then he answers himself and says, none. But he gives us a solution in Isaiah chapter 1, verses 18. He tells us, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as red as crimson, they shall be as white as
snow.
The need for Christ.
We're not born in sin, or we're not born sinner. That means a newborn baby doesn't need Christ. We're exempting our babies from needing Christ. That means if you does it touch your point? And then there's a hand up there. Yes. That's what they said. If we, then no one is perfect except.
That's why you have to be baptized, by the way. Otherwise, you could have gone without baptism.
Okay, there's a hand in the back.
I was going to be more controversial, so.
So you want to hold it, assume it's always clear.
Yeah, so it's to address that same answer. So. It's probably like a taboo subject when we talk about homosexuals, and then they say that some are born that way. Mm-hmm. And then we argue saying nobody's born that way, they inherit these thinkings or attitudes after they're born because of their environment. So if we're saying, yes, we're born sinners, so would that be the case for people who practice homosexuality?
And
you are saying yes.
I was going to agree with that because we are born sinners. It doesn't say you are born a thief or you are born an adulterer or you are born a what, but we are born sinners. We just need Christ to erase the sin. Or we just need, probably before it germinates. We need Christ to erase the sin before it germinates. If it wasn't Christ, think of anyone any type of sin you think you can think of, it could have been, or they could have multiplied on anybody. But because of Christ, that's why you probably have made me. I'm just trying to say this to illustrate the point. That's why we have the much little sins we have to be. If it wasn't for Christ, it would be worse.
But if you are on the street and nobody asks you the same question, and we're saying that you are born sinners, so does it mean that Christ was also born a sinner?
Where do we draw the line? If someone asks you, so Christ was born a sinner, what do you want to say? If Christ, we are born sinners, so Christ was born a sinner. So, he took a sinful flesh, but he was born a sinful
flesh.
But
he did not
conceived in sin. Is put that way? Like David says.
I think you are right. Because if Christ was not a sinner, he would not have said sin. He would not have actually been said sin. So what Christ came to do was to show us that we can, though we are all sinners, we can be sin. Because if we say Christ was not a sinner,
Yes, that's true. Because like I said, the illustration I gave earlier on, you are born in a family of known for sin. Right? You are born in a family known for sin through our parents, Adam and Eve. So there's no, at any point, we will try to say, no, yes, I'm born in there, but I'm not part of it. We make him a liar if we say we have no sin. Right. But for Christ, I want to help on that. Yeah, like Christ was born in a sinful flesh, but godly. He was God.
Jesus Christ was not brought that way.
Yeah.
you know what I mean? It was given by experience.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think it was a thing. Somebody has to help me that way. Because it was not two people, man and man.
Mm-hmm. Man and man.
The point that's made by the Bible here, anything that becomes flesh becomes sinful.
I think
okay. You want to hear?
Yeah, I'm going to use it's a very cool example that you just make. I think. What if you're cooking fufu?
Fufu, yeah.
You get a pot. It's a bed somewhere someone decides to deposit in that pot. You don't wash it, you just take your sofa and put it in that fufu. Is that fufu still clean?
It's not clean.
Why?
It's not clean.
Because
it's not clean.
After some time, you said it's a cool setting. What simply happened is this. God actually decided to come and take residence in a sinful flesh. And by so doing, he didn't grow a holy body out of that sinful flesh. It was the sinful flesh that he took upon himself. Until he went there on the cross, so that he can bring us from that sinfulness.
You wanted to say something? Are you still on?
It's a long passage, of course, it actually talks about our nature, which is from the Romans chapter 3, from verse 9, because it's too long to be
If you can just summarize it, can you summarize it?
It simply shows us that us as human beings, none of us is without sin.
Yep.
We are all sinners,
mm-hmm.
regardless whether whatever you think of yourself, we are all sinners.
Yep.
But the only person who can make us sinless is to receive Jesus in our lives. So in a way, Jesus took the sinful nature. Let's think about it. When Jesus appeared before Moses, in the form of the holy people.
Mm-hmm.
What only Moses could see was the dirt and fire.
Mm-hmm.
By then, Jesus was not yet born.
Mm-hmm.
He was still in the heavenly body,
mm-hmm.
which was absolutely sinless. But being born in an earthly body, which is sinful, that's the only way you could see him. That's the only way you could touch him. He was simply bearing that body, but he himself, in a godly body, no one could see him. Moses could not see him, he just saw the burning fire, because if he had seen him, he was going to die.
Mm-hmm.
So Jesus was born in a sinful body, but he himself is not sinful. He did not see.
Right. Let's move away from comparing Jesus with ourselves. Let's come back to ourselves as sinners. Paul in the book of Romans chapter 7, he writes something that I'll comment. That'll come on later on. He longed for purity, the righteousness to which in himself he was powerless to attain. And he cried out, "Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death?" Such is a cry that has gone up from the burdened hearts in all lands and in all ages. So that should be the cry of each and every individual. That should be the cry of you and I today. That oh, wretched person I am because of sin. Who can deliver me from this evil? And listen to this. To all, there is just but one answer. Behold the Lamb of God which takes away the sin of the world. So if we realize our wretchedness, if we realize
our form, our shape, our character, being of sin or sinful, we will remember or realize that there's only one person who can clean us from our iniquity. That's why the book says, "Behold the Lamb of God." So, in conclusion, what we are saying in chapter 2 is that we, because we are born on this side of heaven, we are sinners. There's nothing that we can do on our own to cleanse ourselves from being sinful or to be righteous except Christ. How? Because we're born, remember how we started, we're born since the fall of our parents. It says, look at the point, at the PowerPoint, Satan gained control of human minds. Since the fall, since that day, we never thought straight. We never thought straight. Our thought pattern went the other way. Right? But if we do not accept Christ today and get our minds changed, we will not be happy today, I mean in heaven, and we will not be happy today unless we accept Christ. Right? Christ will change that thinking, that thought pattern, which went haywire after sin. So Christ will come in, if we accept Christ in our lives, he will change our thought pattern to be straight with God. Right?
Can I give you a verse that support?
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Romans chapter 5.
Romans 5, verse?
Verse 18 and 19.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Adam's one sin brings condemnation forever.
Forever.
But Christ's one act of righteousness brings the right relationship. Life forever.
Right.
Because one person disobeyed God, many became sinners.
Yes.
But because one other person obeyed God, many would be righteous.
Right. Elder Kanyoko wants to say something?
Just to Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, I want to say, it says, let this mind be in you, not in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal to God, but made himself with no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men, and being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even to the cross.
Right? So, do we see the point that are coming up here? We on our own are inclined to think, because we're controlled by Satan, we're like his robots, we're like he's holding the remote control. He makes us go that way. He makes us. But if we come under God, we will do his will. And we do the right thing. We are born selfish in place of love. Or we are born in a selfish world, or we are born in an environment which conditions us to be selfish. Right? We're born. That's what I'm trying to say. The sinful environment that we are now born into will make us think sinfully, or will make us act the sinful way, the non-righteous way. So the sinful way is not Christ's way. But for us to stop sinning or to stop acting or living in sin, that says the point there, we need who? We need Christ. So that point, all these points are showing us that we cannot live on our own. We cannot live a righteous life on our own. We cannot live a righteous life in this world. If we look at this point here, in this world, or in heaven. Without Christ, we cannot live in happiness here. No, we will live in happiness in heaven. Because we need Christ. With Christ on earth, we will live a happy life on earth, and we will live happily even ever after in heaven. With Christ. So this is all pointing that in what in every step on the way we need Christ. In every act of strength, intellect, or anything, we are dependent on Christ. You may have achieved everything. You may be good at everything. You may feel holy, but still, it's not by your mind, but you still need Christ. So this lesson on its own, this chapter on its own, is telling us that in every step on the way, because we are on this side of heaven, we need Christ to take us to heaven. Because we are living on this non-righteous side of heaven, we need Christ to take us into the righteous realms of heaven. So, as long as we are here, as long as we are born in this world, carrying this flesh, that's why the Bible says this corruptible flesh should be changed to incorruptible. Then we can see heaven. And still doesn't mean we will not need Christ then. The Bible doesn't know that. But anyway, for today and in this life, in this world, we need Christ and we are dependent on Christ.
So going back to the first one, just to wind up before we go, we're saying
God's love for man is shown in nature. He gave us life through nature. We get our food, we get our healing, we get our oxygen, he takes our carbon dioxide and purifies it. Because he loves us, we could be living in carbon dioxide without the trees and everything. Right? Meat eaters, it's nature. We get our meat from nature, isn't it? That's God's creation. So he made the world for us because he gave us responsibility over that. So his love is shown in nature. His love for us is shown through nature and in nature. His love for us is shown in the Bible, the Holy Book. If you want to go to the Holy Book, you will see the love. See what manner of love that God bestowed on us so that we can be called children of God. So that's his love. You can see it in his word. And also,
I'm just tempted to say,
okay,
the word of God you are talking about. You can see when we start in God has said, whether Jesus was born in sin or not in sin. It was only when we studied.
Going to the word of God. It clarified it. It clarified it.
Otherwise, if we introduce our own imagination, we could be happy with that.
Yes, true. Thank you for that. The life of Jesus Christ, if you look at the life of Jesus Christ, you will see the love of God. He was a boy, like my boy, right? Both sinners. But because of his life, the godly life that was bestowed on him, where is he now? He managed to cleanse the world of his sins. Look at the life of Jesus. He mingled up with men, desiring their good, healing. He was healing their sick, opening the eyes of their blind, and the deaf ears were opened. It was because of his God's love for us. The plan of salvation was none other than to express his love for us. Okay? Now, these are the supporting verses. If you want, I can make handouts and go email them to anybody or whatever, or you can copy them there. Those who can take pictures, you can take the pictures from the screen. They are telling us all about God's love for you and I on this world, in this world. And like we said here, through the fall, Satan gained control. So you want me to go back to the verses? Okay. Okay. Done. We're saying here, Satan managed to gain the control of human mind soon after the fall, or at the fall. Certain money to gain the human mind. So, as anything that's called a human being is being the mind and the mentality, the thinking and everything, the thought pattern is controlled by the devil. So, we need Christ to free us from that. Without Christ, our sinful mind, unless our sinful minds are changed, by Jesus himself, will never live a happy life here or on any planet, even in heaven. Without Christ, because we're born in this sinful flesh, we need Christ to change it so that we live a life of love. So, guilty as we may be and our hearts being evil, Christ offers us a hand, a brand new mind, and a new life can be received if we take him as our Savior. And the following verses will support this. Those who want to take pictures of it. These verses, they point and illustrate our need for Christ, a sinner's need for Christ. If we look at them at our own time, we understand the need for Christ. So, as we go out today, let's take out the most important things. Christ's love, God's love is revealed in the world around us. It's revealed in the book, and it's revealed if you go and read the life of Christ. And if you look at the plan of salvation, we see God's love for us. So as we speak to people about the book Steps to Christ, it is important that we illustrate some of those important points to show God's love. And being sinners as we are, we need nothing or none other than Christ to change our stature. We need Christ to wash our sins away. We need also, us as Adventists or as evangelists, we need to tell people, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Full stop. There's nothing we can do. I like a point that was raised earlier by the preacher. He said, we don't need to convert people, but let people know the love of God. Let people know their need for Christ. This is our one important thing that we need to take from the book Steps to Christ as we conclude. Let people know the love of God. Let people know their need for Christ. They may think they are not sinners, but still, because we are on this side of heaven, we need Christ to take us to heaven. Any other comments before we pray?
Just a brief comment for each one of us. You know, when we'll be going out, those are the same questions that we'll be receiving. But it's not meant for them alone. Even ourselves, we need to understand this. And I like the examples that we're given here. Those examples, even God uses examples because he knows through examples, practical things that we can be able to see, it's easier for humankind to understand. And that's why, even when you talk of like the plan of salvation, for the children of Israel, he had to bring something that is physical, the tabernacle, so that they can understand, so that they can be able to see. So it's really a good interaction and a very good course that you're looking at. And it's also opening our minds so that we can be able to interact much with the Bible. And it's really that encouraging thing.
Thank you very much.
Unless it is given, the receivers will not get it. So once we are ready, that God should use us as evangelists to go out there and share the love of God with others, we have to also pray. The student of the Bible is also a student of prayer. I believe both. You know, so I want to encourage you from prayer ministry point of view, as we stand together to go out there, we need to back it with prayers. Let's pray that God will, endow us with His Holy Spirit. He's a great teacher. Even by the time you meet somebody, you might not even think of what you're going to say. That very moment, the word will give it, and it's true prayer. Let us unlock the heavenly treasures that God will give us the wisdom that we need to.
Thank you very much. Just keep it because we lost. The next time we meet, we'll be talking about repentance and confession. Let's go and do the two chapters so that we understand where we're coming from and where we're going, so that at least we probably to save us time and a bit more questions will be thrown in and a bit more answers will be coming from everywhere. So may the Lord bless us as we understand, as we try to, as this will sink into us, that God loves us. And since He loves us, He Himself will, He Himself sent His Son to redeem us. And we cannot do anything as far as repentance or getting to God without Him, because He says He is the door, He is the way of salvation, He is the bread that you should feast on, He is the door, and He is the only way we can get to the Father. So let's understand all this, and unless we repent and confess our sins, we will strive.